everybody. As promised, we're going to go ahead and take you all through mini lecture 10.4, going through the last little part of chapter 10 on agriculture. And today's focus is really on why farmers are going to face some economic difficulties, but really one of the most inclusive and important pieces of today's lecture is understanding this right here. One of the biggest issues that farmers are going to face is their ability to access the market. What good is growing the food, especially in a commercial economy, if you can't get somewhere where you can sell it? The whole purpose of our economy revolves around that trade, so if you can't make it happen, and if you can't do it in an efficient way, we have a significant problem. And to combat this, a German geographer by the name of Johann Heinrich von Thunen in 1826 put together a model. It's the first really big model we're going to start to understand about economic geography. We call it the von Thunen model. It'll also sometimes be called the agricultural land use model. The concept that is at the very core of everything involving von Thunen is that the idea that the choice of the crop that you're growing is related to its proximity to the market. The choice of the crop you're growing is directly related to its proximity to the market. The further out from the city, or the further out from the market that your good is, the more time and energy, or the less time and energy, and the cheaper the land that it takes to do it. The closer to the city it is, the more expensive the land. And you see here at the bottom, this is a figure that's from your textbook. The first is the very nice, clean, circular von Thunen, where everything kind of folds into itself. But let's face it, no city is designed like that. So you take a look at the right, that's a little more realistic version of von Thunen. Most cities are going to find themselves close to a river, and as a result, because they do need access to water and the access to be able to trade, you're going to see kind of everything branch out from there, again, moving out in the same direction. Now, the von Thunen model itself, it's based on the spatial arrangement of crops in northern Germany, according to von Thunen, what he saw in the early 19th century. But to do this, he made an assumption. And remember, when you make these kinds of assumptions, that's not necessarily the case everywhere. The assumption is that all the land had the same basic kind of site characteristics and uniform quality, but it could vary based on its topography, on the geography, the physical geography of the region here. Okay? The farms that were located closer to markets would select the crops that had the higher transportation costs. So obviously, if something is relatively cheap to transport, it can be way further out. But if something is either going to spoil very quickly or is going to be a lot more expensive to transport, it's closer to the city. To the right here, you see another version of it. And this is one of the fast ways that I want you to try and remember von Thunen's model. If you see here, we have our central city, represented by the black dot in the center. Immediately surrounding that black dot is an area for market gardening and dairying. Remember, market gardening is our fruits and vegetables. They're the things that will spoil the fastest, so they need to be able to get access to market quickly. So will dairy. That's our milk shed, if you remember from dairy farming. Remember, 1826, there is no refrigeration, there is no pasteurization, there's nothing. As soon as the milk withdraws from the cow, your timer starts, and you're on the countdown to spoilage. Okay, which is why it's still in many parts of Europe, you still see that daily milk delivery. Okay, so there's your milk shed. The next region out is forest. Why is the next region out forest? First of all, you need wood to build just about everything you want to build, and wood's not exactly light. It's not exactly something you can easily transport. So obviously, that's going to need to be closer. The third one out is our, what we call, increasingly extensive field crops and grains. That's your wheat, that's your corn, that's your soy, that's all those basic cereal crops that you need. And then the furthest out, the easiest thing to transport, is our ranching and our livestock. Okay? Take a look at the acronym that you see down here. Okay? C-M-F-I-R-L. Here is what I want you to remember to help you remember von Thunen. Okay? It's a bad joke, but by now you should know I'm going to make these. So get over it. Mr. Sabato's over here making fun. He can make all the fun he wants, but he knows he's going to get the joke and he knows it's going to work. Here it goes. Here's the joke, and it'll help you remember it. Pay attention and take a look at our key down here that I'm highlighting with the mouse. Why was von Thunen sad? Because he can't make friends in real life. Can't Central City make market gardening and dairying, friends, forest, in the increasingly extensive field crops and grains, real life, ranching and livestock? It's goofy, it's silly, but sometime near the AP exam I'm going to go, hey kids, why was von Thunen lonely? He can't make friends in real life. And you're going to remember it, and it's going to stick with you. Deal with it. That's how life works. Remember, farmers are going to consider two things when they're transporting goods. And this is going to be the same when we get to industry, when we talk about industrial goods. They're considering transportation cost, and they're considering the cost of the land. Okay? So, keep those things in mind as we continue. Von Thunen is key. I cannot emphasize this enough. You must know this model. Learn it. So what other kinds of difficulties will farmers face? Well, if you think about commercial farmers in the modern era, because we have gotten so good at what we do, because we have gotten to the point now where we can create so much extra food, we have actually resulted in overproduction. We're producing more than we need, okay? When you get to 12th grade, you're going to learn about supply and demand. Now, you don't have that background right now, and nobody's expecting you to have that background right now. So let me give you a little tip, okay? When supply is super, super high, there's a lot of a good to be sold, but the demand, as we see here, has remained relatively constant. Something happens to prices. They start dropping, and the prices will keep dropping until they reach something we'll call in economics equilibrium. When prices finally reach that equilibrium, sometimes they are too low for farmers to support themselves. And as a result, income for farmers is extremely low. So overproduction is a very key problem because eventually these farmers cannot support themselves on a low amount of money they're being given for the goods they're producing. The second one is about sustainable agriculture. What do we do to guarantee that we can continue farming and taking care of the land and the space we have in the future? So we're going to talk about those two in a little more detail here. We just explained to you again, via supply and demand, why overproduction leads to lower prices. Again, when the supply is too much, the demand remains steady or goes down, it results in prices dropping until the demand meets the supply. Okay? One of the reasons why, remember, is because of the new facets of technology, the Green Revolution, etc., that have kind of helped agriculture to be so much more efficient. Better seeds, although we'll leave that out of it, better seeds, fertilizers, pesticides, better mechanical equipment. You can do everything for cheaper, faster, better. Okay, to give you an example from the dairy industry, from the 1960s until 2005, okay, we have literally cut the number of dairy cows in the United States by 50%, but the amount of milk we get per cow, the yield per cow, has tripled. Why? Because now we have equipment that's able to milk a cow faster than having to do it the old-fashioned way. Okay? This makes it obviously a lot faster. You're able to produce a lot more and a lot quicker. Okay? But here's the problem. American consumption habits don't change if the commodity prices change. Food's an important part, ultimately, of our budgets in life, but ultimately, if one good gets a little more expensive, if it's an extra dollar, people are still buying. So as a result, the consumption habits don't seem to change as quickly as humanly possible, which is, you know, the farmers would wish they'd react a little better, but that's not going to happen. So there have been three government solutions, three ways that the United States government has checked in to try and help overproduction. First of all, it's by encouraging some farmers to plant fallow, to basically not plant all their farm, to plant some clover, to plant other items. Typically, to do this, they're going to subsidize. Okay? When the prices get super low, the U.S. government, especially for the last 40 or 50 years, has had a habit of being the strongest subsidizers of the American farmer. And that will continue to happen here. And then last comes to last, the U.S. government, as we've spoken before, will either purchase the food from the farmers and either donate it through the U.S. Agency for International Development, USAID, or they will sell it to other countries to be able to generate more funds for that additional, for those additional goods. Okay. In 2005, we spent in the United States $25 billion, that's billion with a B, billion dollars on farm subsidies. So a significant amount of money goes into this. Be aware of that as we go through. European subsidies tend to be a little greater than the United States, mainly because you also have higher taxes and partially you have a higher need for some of those goods to be produced in Europe rather than being imported in. It helps preserve rural life in Europe, but unfortunately we're also going to see much higher commodity prices, much higher agricultural prices in Europe as a result of those higher subsidies. Okay, so sustainable agriculture. Okay, sustainable agriculture is any type of agriculture that preserves and enhances environmental quality. We talked about agriculture at the beginning of the unit as this item that is an intentional modification of the Earth's surface. Now, sustainable agriculture will take it one step further, not only intentionally modifying it, but also preserving and enhancing it. There's three main ways we're going to see that type of sustainable agriculture. The first is through sensitive land management. The second is through a limited use of chemicals and pesticides. And the third is through a better integration of crops and livestock into a farm. So one of those big ways when we talk about sensitive land management and the rest, we'll also take a look at what we call organic farming. Many of you might eat foods that are organically produced. Now, first off, the group that decides what is and is not organic is the U.S. Department of Agriculture. And as we've discussed, sometimes the U.S. Department of Agriculture might have its own viewpoints on what is and is not organic. In 2003, it was estimated that about 0.2% of American farmland was organic. Okay, 0.2%. So we are not talking an extremely high number here. Okay? The world leader in organic production is Australia with a whopping 2.7%. I know, bat down the hatches and lock the doors, 2.7%, that's going to change the world. But little steps to make that move. You're going to see much higher organic farming in MDCs than in LDCs. LDCs have come to grow and be extremely connected to the effects of the Green Revolution, which are not organic. Okay? Obviously, the higher the yield of crop, wheat, soybean, and corn, the crops we're planting the most, are the lowest percentage of organic, going all the way down to about 0.1%. Now, in terms of sensitive land management, one of the ways that we're going to try and take care of the land we're growing is through something called ridge tillage. Ridge tillage is where we plant crops intentionally on the top of a ridge to try and conserve soil and to lower our costs. Ultimately, by putting it on these higher ridges, it gives us an opportunity to have a little bit better use of the land. It's not always our best choice, and it's not always going to be possible, geographically speaking. Okay, it's going to result in less investment in tractors and machinery, and it's a little more profitable on a per-acre basis. In fact, in Iowa, you see the production of organic soybeans via ridge tillage. It can be effective, but again, not always going to be most efficient or most possible for every farmer. Okay. The second one is the limited use of chemicals. And we talked about when we watched Food Inc. and you had the opportunity to do your writing assignment afterwards. Note, writing assignment, not the E word, not going to catch me that easily. The issue of GMOs, genetically modified organisms. Okay. Most of those chemicals are helping to preserve and guarantee the actual viability of these crops. Now, most of the GMOs that we've seen are through something called Roundup Ready seeds. A Roundup Ready seed is a genetically modified seed, soy or corn, that's been created to be able to survive an herbicide or insecticide. Bear in mind that if we were to just plant a field of crops automatically, because of the circle of life that we all live in, and I hear one Timon or Pumbaa reference, we're going to have a problem here. Because of that circle of life, there are going to be pests, there's going to be bugs, there's going to be other things that are trying to eat that grain. To protect the grain, you spray it with a herbicide or a pesticide or an insecticide. Monsanto is the main producer of one of these called Roundup. But what they wanted to do is to produce the seed that if you sprayed it with Roundup, it would not kill the seed and just kill the bug. Okay? Bad news is these two seeds, ultimately, there's an adverse impact on the soil and water quality because you're now able to just completely spray it with pesticides. And as a result, you wind up growing weeds and other items that are going to be resistant to herbicides. Okay? Eventually, it just doesn't work anymore. Okay? More sustainable agriculture, more organic-style agriculture, will use less chemicals and less GMOs. Okay? In terms of a better integration of crops and livestock, more modern farms are going to buy crops to feed their livestock. Sustainable agriculture is now going back to that historical practice of growing a crop, using that crop to raise animals. Okay? Now, there's some complexities with this if you're going to try this. Now, we talked about this with crop rotation, and it worked fine with crop rotation. But in modern times, you can't grow enough to feed them, so you need to be able to buy a little bit extra. Okay? Three complexities. The first is you have to find the correct number and distribution of livestock based on what you can actually support. So if you can only support 10 cows, it's not time to go for 20. Secondly, if you're going to confine the animals, you're going to have a few other issues. Obviously, you're not using them to necessarily fertilize fields, so you have to find more locations for them to work. And then extreme weather issues. Okay. When you have extreme weather, the droughts will affect herd size, but the herds can also eat some of the failed crops. So, again, a little better integration can work, but it's a little more difficult given modern systems. Okay, so those are the challenges that commercial farmers face. Now, subsistence farmers really face three other issues. One, we've talked about population growth at length in this course, so you understand kind of where we're going there. International trade isn't always the best for subsistence farmers, and then we've also talked a little bit, but we're going to go into a little more detail today, about drug crops, which is another form of cash crop that might exist on a plantation agriculture system in some LDCs and subsistence situations. Okay. So, if you go back to Unit 2, way back, when we talked about Malthus and a few others of the population theorists who believe that we might run out of food, one of those was Esther Boserup. Boserup said that population growth will basically force subsistence farmers to use new methods, and that the faster population grows, the new methods are going to kind of be forced and foisted upon them no matter what. Okay? So Boserup actually put together this idea that you go through stages as populations grow, and so we can pay attention to see how these stages are happening. The first stage is forest fallow. Forest fallow is that basic shifting cultivation. Hey, dude, let's just come in here, slash it all down, burn it to the ground. Hey, we can use it for 2 years. We'll use it for 2 years. We'll grow the daylights out of it for 2 years. And then we're going to move on to a new patch, and we'll come back to this patch in 10 years. Or, sorry, not 10 years, 20 years. In 20 years, you will have had another forest to grow. So that's more good you can slash, burn, repeat. But then, as more people need to be fed, you need more food. And you need more food, you need more space. And you need more space, you have to use some of the space you're trying to wait. So you move on to bush fallow. Bush fallow, you use it for up to 8 years, but you leave it fallow for 10 years. Okay? Again, you just can't grow as much, but you're growing it much more extensively. Then there's short fallow, where you're on and off for 2 years. Again, watch what's happening to the yield as we do this. They just keep going further and further down. Then there's annual cropping, where you basically use the same field every year. You leave it fallow for a few months, but then you keep growing on it anymore. And then multi-cropping. Multi-cropping is where you use it several times a year, and you never leave it fallow. The problem is, the further down that line you go, the more risks you run into of desertification, the more risks you run into of running out of viable nutrient in the soil, and regrettably, the more you're going to need other assistance, GMOs, other issues to try and help build more crops. This is where the Green Revolution has really helped in LDCs to be able to grow these things on additional land that might not have been able to handle it before. Okay? We've seen throughout this process, though, that as we go, technology's gotten better, and that's the one thing, I guess, Malthus and Bozrup doesn't necessarily take into account was going to be the growth of technology in agriculture to help them. Okay. In terms of subsistence farming and international trade, we've talked about the idea of the cash crop earlier. Remember that in many subsistence farms, you're going to see the use of plantation farms to grow cash crops to be sold in MDCs, to be able to gain cash, to use for fertilizer, to grow more cash crops, to earn more cash, to buy more fertilizer, okay, to eventually feed and sustain their families in that way, okay? In Kenya, for example, you're going to see women who are going to be practicing subsistence agriculture on cash crops and other crops for food, while men would necessarily women would be practicing subsistence agriculture to feed their families, while men would practice agriculture for cash crops, whatever they're going to be. Okay. The last group is drug crops. The UN estimates that approximately 4 million people in Latin America and Asia, and we've seen this in Colombia, we've seen this in Afghanistan, we've seen this in a few other countries, were dependent on the growth of, we see it in Mexico as well, opium, coca leaf, and marijuana. Opium comes from the Golden Triangle of Southeast Asia, typically. We're seeing in Burma, Laos, Thailand, and Vietnam. We also see some of this opium being grown in Afghanistan, Pakistan, and called the Golden Crescent. This is where the Taliban made a lot of its money to be able to support itself, was through the growth of opium and sale of opium in the black market around the world. Coca plants, which lead to cocaine, from Bolivia, Colombia, and Peru, and marijuana from Mexico. Now, the issue with all three of these crops, you have to understand that most of the farmers who are put in this situation, they're not considering it, we're growing crops, they're considering it, we're growing something to help sell to feed our family. Okay? So you have subsistence farmers who are left in that situation, so this is the one thing they can turn to. And so, to be able to feed their family, that's the action they choose to take. In terms of the drug trade, you have this figure from your textbook that kind of shows you what is going from where. Okay, again, our coca production in South America, Bolivia, Peru, and Colombia, and you're going to see the production starting in that region and then, again, transporting and trafficking through large portions of the world. Our opium in, again, the Golden Crescent, or the Golden Crescent and the Golden Triangle, and then you can see the countries who are here in green have had some level of cannabis or marijuana production. We also see the production of amphetamine-type stimulants in some of these countries as well. And so you can see generally where the traffic's going. But pay attention here to the number of LDCs that are involved in this process, and to a degree the number of MDCs. See Mexico, see US, see Canada, see Australia, see France, see the UK on this list as well. So how are farmers who are facing these kinds of difficulties going to increase their food supply? Well, there's four main methods. We're going to look for them to try and expand their agricultural land. There's a risk here, and that's facing desertification, as we're going to go into here in a little bit more next year. There's increasing their productivity via the Green Revolution, trying to use those additional technological gaps to try and build and increase your productivity. There's identifying new food sources. What can we do in terms of the oceans, higher protein cereals, and palatability of certain foods, and then just in general, increasing trade. So, four big strategies, which we've talked about just there. Let's talk about expanding land area. In 1950, we reached a point where human population was increasing far faster than the expansion of agricultural land. So one of two things was going to have to happen, or we were going to start heading down Malthus Way. The big thing was we needed to be able to be more effective in our use of land. But that can only take us so far. So we eventually get to the point where we're trying to expand agricultural land. Now, what could result from this is something called desertification. Desertification is the deterioration of land due to excessive planting, animal grazing, and tree cutting. In essence, what happens is if you continue to just keep growing crops in the same place, over and over and over and over again, eventually you drain all the nutrients from that particular soil. As soon as the nutrients gone, nothing's growing there again. Okay, what you've seen happen, if you take a look at the map here on the right, Okay, you're seeing that desertification take place in some areas. You see the Sahara Desert continuing to move to the south. You see parts of the deserts in Central Asia moving. You also see that same thing in the west. Okay. The United Nations estimates that approximately 70 million acres, or 27 million hectares, of land are being lost from agriculture each year. That can be a significant portion and a serious issue for continually trying to keep our food supply as high as it is, considering the continued growth of our population. Okay. It's estimated that overgrazing by ranching and livestock is responsible for about 34% of that desertification. Deforestation, I'm looking at you, Brazil, about 30%, and agricultural use for the other 28%. Okay. Now, bear in mind, that's talking about too little water, too little nutrient. If you go to the far side of that, too much water can be a negative too. If there's too much water in land, it cannot sustain or be able to grow crops long term. The UN actually estimates that 10% of land is actually waterlogged. We put so much water into it, because we gotta water the crops every day. We put so much water into it that now the land is no longer used. Okay. The second big strategy is higher productivity via the Green Revolution. Now we've already talked about the first agricultural revolution, the second agricultural revolution. Remember that the Green Revolution happened with the third agricultural revolution, which is a rapid diffusion of new and productive technological techniques in the 1970s and the 1980s. Two big practices. The first was the genetically modified organism called the miracle seed. We saw miracle rice and miracle wheat. Okay? These miracle seeds were much less sensitive to variation. They responded better to fertilizer, and they matured a lot faster. But because it all survived, and so you didn't lose as many crops to dead plants, and because it matured faster, you could multi-crop each year. And every time you can multi-crop, you get more wheat. And so more food, better food. Okay, well, more food. The second, remember, we've now also, by the way, seen this with rice and now with corn. This led to India being able to feed itself for the first time. We have not seen a significant famine issue in India for a particularly long period of time. What are they using to fertilize? Nitrogen. Okay. So a lot of those nitrate-based fertilizers are going to be used to try and fertilize these spaces. Instead of using, you know, the all-natural method, you're going to use these artificially chemically based fertilizers, mostly using nitrogens and nitrates that are going to be pumped into the soil. Okay. Big problems with the Green Revolution. First off, none of this comes cheap. And so for commercial farmers, this is all well and good. They can handle it. They're going to complain about it. We've seen that before. But for subsistence farmers, it's way too much money. You got to spend money on fertilizers, machinery, seeds, fuels. It all leads to environmental damage, but it also takes money away from the farmer. Okay? It eventually will force farmers off their land. And you're starting to see this happen in some LDCs where the land starts to kind of congregate. You see these larger farms and people now having to leave their land, move to the cities for industrial jobs. We're going to get to industry soon. It leads to inter-regional migration. Our next one is to try and look for new food sources. Okay? One of those options was to cultivate the oceans. Now, in the last 60, 70 years, we have almost sextupled our entire fish catch in the world. In 1991, it was estimated that we're catching 100 million tons of fish a year. Okay? Now, it's been fairly consistent since around 1980 how much we're catching. The problem is, we're fishing too much. And you hear this all the time. There's going to be a lot of types of fish you're not going to be able to eat very soon because we're going to run out. Okay? Tuna and swordfish, for example, two big ones. Today, you can buy tuna fish in a can. Why can we buy tuna fish in a can? Because they have to find some way to preserve it. Because we're catching so much of it. Tuna and swordfish are estimated down 90%. It's now estimated, actually, that 75% of fish that are available are being overfished or fully exploited. You see the global loss trend here. What's estimated is that if we continue our current trends, it's estimated that before 2050, we might run out of viable seafood. Now, what's sometimes happening is they're trying to create and now farm certain types of fish, but they're feeding them corn. Fish? Corn? No. Alright, second issue is to try and develop a higher protein cereal. Here in the United States, we eat a lot of meat. There's really no way around saying this. We eat more meat in MDCs than you're going to see in LDCs. Okay? So in most LDCs, you're using cereals to make up the proteins. Okay? The idea here is to change the genetic modification of these cereals to give them more protein. If they have more protein, we'll need less meat. Less meat means we'll be able to preserve a lot of those meat sources for a later time. Okay? And then there's improving the palatability of some of the more rarely consumed foods. People are actually typically going to select foods. When we decide, hey, I'm hungry for something, we think about our climate, we think about our culture, and we think about our tastes. Okay? As a result, we don't always go for things that we normally eat. Some of you might eat a lot of veggie burgers, okay, soy-based items. We have seen soybeans turned into burgers, hot dogs, soybean oil, things that can be used to support other types of food. You've seen Asian protein beverages that resemble soft drinks, if you see the one here on the right. Okay? You've even seen some cases where we're seeing krill. Krill are these tiny little fish that typically whales are eating, but krill is it's a crustacean that could be used. There's a lot more krill because we've been overhunting whales. As a result, with all these krill in the ocean, you know, what's a krill here or there? It's a krill drink, I think. We'll see. Okay. Last is to try and increase the exports from other countries. Now, there are three crops that are the number one exports to other countries. That's wheat, corn, and rice. They are the far by anything, the most important exporters. Okay. Prior to World War II, Western Europe was responsible for importing a lot of their food from the colonies. Bear in mind, after World War II, no more colonies. So now, you're seeing that more of the LDCs are importing grain because their population increases, and that the only areas of the world that are now net exporters of grain are Southeast Asia and the U.S. and Canada. Thailand recently has actually replaced the United States as the leading exporter of rice in the world. India's second, Vietnam's fourth, Pakistan's fifth. So you've got some heavy hitters in that list. The U.S. is third for it. Okay? The leading importer of grain in the world is actually Japan. Bear in mind, though, we've talked about Japan before. They don't have the geographic capability of being able to grow that much grain. China's number two on the list. The leading net importer, by the way, of all grain overall, aside from there, is the Middle East in terms of the regions. Saudi Arabia was the leader in rice at one time back in 2003. Okay. If you see here, just to take a look at our grain imports and exports, we've been taking a look at these maps all year. I almost show you one of these maps every lecture these days. You can actually see that the importers and exporters don't necessarily follow a clear pattern here. Okay. Exporters can be both MDCs and LDCs. So normally, now we're going to look at individual groups. You have countries like the U.S. and Canada who are net exporters. Same thing with Brazil and Argentina, Australia, and India, even to a degree, has become a net exporter. The net importers, just like China, Japan, Russia, Saudi Arabia, are areas that might not be capable of growing as many crops as humanly possible. It might be also interesting to you to see that Mexico is a net importer. A large reason this is NAFTA. NAFTA is something we're getting into next unit. Okay. For Africa, we're seeing probably the greater problem here, and that is a food supply crisis for them. Of all the continents of the world, Africa benefited the least from the Green Revolution. Even though grain production tripled in the last 50 years, the problem is that the population increased sixfold. So even though we've seen a huge jump in grain production, it's still not enough to feed the population. This is where the neo-Malthus get their idea. They say, ha-ha, Malthus might have a point if you zoom in differently. Okay? It's estimated right now that 40 million Africans, although the number could be higher, face famine. We're seeing 14 million in Ethiopia, which is a strange irony considering that it was originally one of the key hearths for many of the foods in Africa. 7 million in Zimbabwe. We're seeing more in the Horn of Africa to pile on to the conflicts happening in that region. And also the Sahel on the west side, the western end of the Sahara Desert, is seeing some struggle. Okay. As populations continue to increase, as you see, you can take a look here at this population undernourishment. Sub-Saharan Africa far outweighs all the LDCs. And you're seeing that number's dropping, but it's still close to a third. Okay. As population has increased, herd sizes have increased, and farmers overplanted. What wound up happening is that pushed food prices lower, giving farmers no incentive to increase production. Because they weren't increasing production, the food level stayed the same, and the population kept increasing. What we need to do is to try and find a way to create more and additional food for Africa. Okay. Ultimately, though, as we've talked about with Malthus, Malthus was wrong globally, but he might have been right locally. Okay, and we've talked about that idea, and that's what the Neo-Malthus believed. As you can see here, agricultural land and world population have tended to be kind of closely related. Whether that will continue as we approach 7, 8, 9, 10 billion people on the planet is yet to be seen. Here's a few items that are about agriculture that are not in Rubenstein, that are not in your text. The first is the idea of intertillage. Okay, intertillage is the process by which people engage in shifting cultivation, but they plant crops of varying heights. And so they might plant a very tall crop, and then a less tall crop, and then a bush-type crop. You'll do that because typically wind, because of shifting cultivation, might easily blow some of those crops away. It actually protects some of the smaller crops, maybe a little more delicate or fragile crops from being blown away. Okay. Remember we talked about the Swidden. Swidden's only going to get farmed again for 3 years, mainly because tropical soils being used for shifting cultivations are already nutrient poor. They don't have enough to do it a long time. Shifting cultivation, which we've also called the slash and burn agriculture, can also be called Swidden agriculture. Okay. The enclosure movement. The enclosure movement, which we will get into more detail when we talk about the Industrial Revolution next chapter, is something that consolidated farms and encouraged the use of machinery in Great Britain at the time of the Second Agricultural Revolution or the First Industrial Revolution, depending on how you want to call it. Okay. Remember that Second Agricultural Revolution included the advancements in production and technology, but not the transportation improvements. Transportation will come about 20 to 30 years later. Okay. Almost all commercial agriculture, almost all, so not all, but like 97-98%, is intensive, okay? When we say that term, intensive, it means we are going to use as much of the land as best as possible, period, okay? Especially in fixed locations. Ranching, not intensive. Just let the cows go. Everything else, intensive use of land. We've talked about luxury crops. Luxury crops, remember, are those legal crops, things that you would sell but not necessarily live off of. Coffee, tea, tobacco. You can't live on coffee. You can't live on coffee. You can't live on coffee, tea, or tobacco, but you can sell them for a lot of money, and you see that happening on plantations in the tropics to be exported to an MDC. And containerization. We're going to get to containers, the idea of these shipping containers, especially used to now send food around the world. We'll talk about those containers, the containers that go on the ships, and the ships that ship ships, and the ships that ship ships, that ship ships, ships that ship ships. I'm going to give myself 15 minutes here in a minute, so I'm going to stop. Ships that ship ships, that ship ships. We're going to talk about the ships that ship ships, that ship ships. You're wondering, I haven't said it yet. See, I haven't, because I'm good like that. All that being said, we have come to the end of agriculture. Your test is coming up soon, so make sure you're ready. Otherwise, we will see you in class.